All right. Good morning, everyone. We are going to go ahead and get started in the interest of time. My name is Dr. Tamara Henry, and I'm a teaching associate professor at the Milken Institute School of Public Health in Washington, D.C., at George Washington University. Thank you so much for being present this morning. Today, we're going to discuss cultural competence in healthcare. And kind of what it looks like in theory and what it looks like in practice. And you all feel free to jump in and share your experiences as it relates to cultural competence. So before we get started, I just wanted to take some time and acknowledge the folks that we have today on this webinar. If you could type in what your position is or what it is that you do for your organization, that would be wonderful and help me to ask you questions that may arise as we have today's discussion. So you have the option, obviously, to take yourself off camera, to unmute if you're more comfortable with doing that. If you are not, feel free to let me know in the chat. Okay, thank you, Jessica. I see your prevention coordinator. And we have a program director to increase colorectal cancer screening. Okay, thank you. It's always good to just know who is in the room so that I can ensure that I'm speaking to you and providing you with skills that you can possibly use with the populations you work with. All right, thank you. We have some clinical social workers on and the like. So as you continue to place in the chat what it is that you do, again, it would be really helpful to the discussion. If you are able to turn on your cameras, great. And if not, that's fine too. So as it relates to the learning objectives, by the end of this webinar, you all will be able to distinguish the difference between cultural competency and humility, identify how these challenges of marginalized or underrepresented people impact one's health, and describe strategies to incorporate cultural competency in your respective organizations. Thank you again for those of you who are able to participate in the chat. By definition, cultural competence could be described and defined as the ability of providers and organizations to effectively deliver healthcare services that meet the social, cultural, and linguistic needs of our patients. I'm going to stop sharing for a minute and ask Jason to pull up the first video. Share sound, Jason. I do it. I do it.
Hi there.
Hi.
Nice day, huh?
Yeah, finally, right?
Where are you from? Your English is perfect.
San Diego. We speak English there.
Oh, no. Where are you from?
Well, I was born in Orange County, but I never actually lived there.
I mean before that.
Before I was born.
Yeah, like, where are your people from?
Well, my great-grandma was from Seoul.
Korean. I knew it. I was like, she's either Japanese or Korean. But I was leaning more towards Korean.
Amazing.
Yeah. Hamshasina. There's a really good teriyaki barbecue place near my apartment. So I actually really like kimchi.
Cool. What about you? Where are you from?
San Francisco.
But where are you from?
Oh, I'm just American.
Really? You're Native American?
No, just regular American. Oh, well, I guess my grandparents are from England.
Oh, well,
morning.
Top of the morning to you. Let's get a smartie, smartie.
Double, double, toil and trouble.
Mind the gap.
Beware, Jack the Ripper.
Bloody hell.
Pip, pip. Cheerio.
I think your people's fish and chips are amazing.
You're weird.
Really? I'm weird? Must be a Korean thing.
Thanks, Jason. And can you go to the one with the healthcare provider next? And then we're going to debrief and discuss momentarily.
Nurse Rita, I'm going to be doing your vitals this morning.
Okay.
How are you feeling?
I'm feeling well.
Okay, well, I'm just going to listen to your lungs first, all
right?
Okay. And turn you around.
Oh my God! What are these marks on your back? Are you being abused?
What?
What? You know, I'm a mandatory reporter. I have to tell people about this.
What's going on? What?
I gotta tell people, you're being abused. You need to be protected.
No.
You need to be in a shelter.
No.
Do you have money to get away from your husband?
What?
I gotta go. I can't do this. How should I refer to you?
Oh, my name is Koik.
Oh, hi, Koik.
How are you?
Oh, I'm good, thank you. I'm going to be doing morning vitals with you this morning.
Okay.
So I'm just going to first start with your lungs and listen
okay.
to them from the back. Is
okay.
that all right?
Yeah.
Okay. Oh, okay. I noticed some interesting marks on your back. What are those from?
Oh, I'm Cambodian. It's part of my culture. We do a method of form of pain relief called cupping. I wasn't feeling well mm-hmm. a couple days ago, and I had my husband do it for me.
Oh, okay.
Okay, yeah. I know, it looks a little...
So, I'm just worried about signs and symptoms of infection, so I can tell you about those later.
Okay.
So, just in case of bruising, you'll know, understand what the signs and symptoms are, and you can come to us, and we'll treat you for that.
Oh, no, it's
right.
fine.
But thank you for telling me
about
that.
Oh, no problem.
I'll know that for the next time.
Okay.
Thank you. Nurse.
Huh.
I'm going to go in, I'm doing my rounds, and I'm going to tell this patient she has terminal cancer. Do you have anything to add to that?
No, I'm good.
All right. Patient, you have terminal cancer. You are going to die.
Todo, pero no el amor. Es la misión más grande que tenemos tú y yo.
Hello, Nurse Megan.
What can I help you with?
I'm going into this patient's room and I'm making my rounds and I have to give her bad news. She has terminal cancer. Anything you want to add to that?
We definitely need to wait because she's Ethiopian, and in their culture, you need to tell the family spokesperson.
Really?
But first we have to go to the ethics committee to make sure that's okay because it could be a HIPAA violation.
Oh, well, I'm so glad you're a nurse on my floor.
Thank you. Well, good luck with that.
Good morning.
Good morning.
My name is Brenda. I'm going to be your nurse today.
Hi, Brenda. Hi, Brenda.
Okay, congratulations on your new baby, Mom.
Aw, thanks.
Thanks.
Okay. Well, I'm going to, this is the birth certificate. I'm going to need you to fill out your name here, Mom. And then when Dad gets here later, you can just have him fill this out.
There's no Dad.
What do you mean, there's no Dad? You have a baby, lady.
We're a same-sex couple.
What?
So there's no Dad.
What? How does that work?
I mean, I guess you could write A165794 under the father's name.
What the hell is that?
Sperm bank number?
Wow. Okay, so are you the daddy?
There's no dad.
Well, are you the father figure?
No, I am the mother, and she's a mother too.
Doesn't that confuse your baby?
No.
Oh, wow. Okay, look, you figure it out. When you're done, let me know. Okay. Fill out your information, and no rush, I can always come back for it later. And you, if your plan is to adopt, you can always, you know, have that done later.
Definitely.
Okay, I'm sure you know that already.
Yeah, well, thanks for telling me, because some people don't know.
Yeah, well, don't worry about it. I'm just doing my job. So fill it out when you're ready, and I'll come back when you're done.
Oh,
okay. Have you guys decided what Barry's going to call you, though?
We're not quite sure.
Yeah. Okay, well, have a good day. Use your call bell when you need me, and I'll come and get this later.
Build the world a home and finish it with a lawn. Grow apple trees and honeybees and snow white turtle doves. I'd like to teach the world to sing in perfect harmony.
All right, everyone. So you just saw a couple of videos that indicate how we may engage with some of our diverse populations. So were any of the videos familiar to you in terms of how we may operate in the world today or in the organizations in which we work? And you can unmute yourselves or you can speak in the chat.
Hi, this is Mayema Fala speaking. So I think the second video was very relatable, especially in the healthcare field. I think there are some healthcare professionals who really don't understand that each ethnicity has like its own cultural background and tradition when it comes to understanding like certain medical conditions or certain medical terminology. And also I feel like just the way it's delivered, it just needs to be a little bit more sensitive the way it's delivered. And also, it's also helpful for like healthcare professionals to do background research regarding that specific culture and how they receive medical advice and just like the proper way to go about it. So the second video was very familiar.
Thank you so much. Anyone else wish to contribute, even in terms of how providers may make assumptions about partnerships, relationships? Is that familiar? Assuming that there's a father involved, instead of just another parent. Ngozi, hi, welcome.
Hello. I like the second video best because the lady didn't know anything, but she used inquiry to find out and showed appreciation for the learning, which we need to see more of, I think, when we're faced with new situations that or contexts that we don't understand. So that one resonated with me most from a teaching or learning perspective. Well, this is how you ask respectfully and find out, even if you don't know. So.
Another question I have for you all, especially for those of you who are providers and/or interact with providers on a regular basis, what are some of the barriers? Why do you think providers are less able or less likely to inquire in the method that you saw the other part of the video do? So you saw them do it the culturally incompetent way, and then you saw them do it the competent way. What are some of the barriers that you think may exist that prohibit folks from doing that? So, Sabrina, thank you for raising your hand.
I did notice that in the second part, like the second part of that video where the nurse was helping the doctor and letting the doctor know, like that stood out to me quite significantly because there are steps that can be taken to make sure that everybody is treated with the proper compassion. And that's what I actually started thinking about, that why are the reasons why those extra steps aren't taken. It could be, you know, time, it could be lack of knowledge, but like I think that is a really huge barrier, is knowing those extra steps and actually taking the time to do those extra steps.
Thank you. Thank you, Sabrina. Rob?
Yeah, this is Rob Shore. I think some of it is having worked in a doctor's office. I'm in a non-healthcare setting now, but some of it is the systems that are used, forms that don't allow for the right questions to be asked, or databases that don't let you enter another option for sex, but male or female. And so you're confined by the systems that haven't moved forward the way individuals have.
Okay. Yeah, good. So that means we have to do work on the systems as well if we are moving towards cultural competency. So that's something we don't get to talk about as often, is the fact that there are systems put in place, oftentimes not even by the hospital. This is a consultant or contractor that may be less culturally competent that are implementing these systems. And then we as a community have to decide how best to adapt it for our population. So that's something that we often do not discuss as much with respect to cultural competency. So thank you all for your comments. So cultural competence is a process, right? You don't just wake up culturally competent because the world is different. It's complex, especially the United States of America. It's becoming more diverse on a daily basis. So to keep up with cultural competency or becoming culturally proficient, it means that you have to spend your time as a lifelong learner. So as you look at this slide, I want you to kind of think about where you lie in between cultural incompetence and culturally competent. Are you an individual that lacks this cultural awareness and thinks there's only one way of doing things? Do you feel superior to other cultures? Or do you recognize that there are differences and nuances and cultures that you are interested in learning about? And I believe that most of us do think that people are all people are created equal and should be treated similarly. But we know, just based on the research alone, that that is not in fact the case. What we're moving towards is what I mentioned, being an active, lifelong learner that seeks to learn about other cultures, cultures other than your own. So when we consider the goal of cultural competence in healthcare, it's really about removing those barriers that get in the way of patients receiving the care that they need. And with respect to Rob and Sabrina's last statements around why we can't take 5 minutes to learn about this particular culture, or why is it that we have a system that's in place that only seeks to capture data one way and not in an inclusive manner? Could it be a cost barrier? And what do we need to do to mitigate it so that we can have more inclusive systems? As I mentioned, the population, according to much of our research and census data, suggests that it will be majority minority sooner than later. What are we doing in healthcare to really scale up in terms of our capability of meeting the needs of this diverse patient group? In addition, we know that as the culture diversifies linguistically, there will be a number of challenges as we seek to serve our populations that speak languages other than English. And as according to the Office of Minority Health, we also know that the class standards need to be delivered in an equitable manner that includes it being effective, understandable, and respectful. So we know that in some of our healthcare settings, we have relatives translating. Sometimes we have an in-house translation service, and some are better than others, but recognizing there are things that can be lost in translation, especially when discussing health information from the patient to the provider and vice versa. So one of the more recent discussions around cultural competency is that of cultural humility. And cultural humility involves more of the perspective of equity. And when I say it involves more of an equity framework and basis, it starts to really delve into holding systems accountable. So how can I work with an institution to ensure that the systems, i.e. down to your database, work towards greater inclusion and equity? It also seeks to understand and address those power imbalances. So if you notice that you look different from the population you serve, or you have a background different from the population you serve, or you are a person in power and no one else looks like the population you serve, what do you do to be a full-fledged ally and or disrupt inequitable systems? So when the population we serve is not present at the table, how do you speak up for them? Cultural humility references that. It references individuals that are not only lifelong learners, but care more about disrupting a broken system and advocate for folks who are not necessarily present, but know that these folks are still in need. This also means that we have to know where we are in the larger paradigm. What is the role we play when it comes to not only being culturally competent, but advocating for others and being self-aware of our respective race, ethnicity, and privilege, and how that may impact how we interact with others. So there are some differences between cultural competence and cultural humility I'd like to turn your attention to. So on this particular slide, what I like to highlight is that of the group traits versus cultural humility being unique to specific individuals. as well as the process, the fact that cultural humility is an ongoing life process, whereas cultural competence typically seems to occur in our organizations as a professional development exercise, right? So it's more or less a cross-sectional activity where we take this training, and depending if it's for CEUs or not, when we're talking about our providers, there's a pre and post test, and now you are culturally competent. Cultural humility is a little different. So it really looks at making bias explicit and recognizes that as the world continues to change and evolve, that we should be flexible, and that flexibility relates to the learning of the information, learning about other cultures, and recognizing just because we've had the ability to sit through 10 cultural competence classes or 4 different cultural competence training events does not make us an expert. We are not yet an expert. And cultural humility recognizes that it doesn't matter how many of these we go to. If you understand this to be a lifelong learning process, then it means there's more for us to learn. So for the next few slides, we're going to talk about how disparities relate to these cultural incompetency issues and what we can do to remedy some of these disparities that we are currently facing. So I'm certain that you all know that health disparities are as a result of preventable differences in burden of disease or opportunities to achieving optimal health that's experienced specifically by socially disadvantaged populations. So if you look at the pie chart, you'll notice that about 60% of our population is non-Hispanic white, but the other 40%, the other 39% are pretty diverse. Hispanic persons who are Latinx at 18.5%, persons who are Black or identify as Black at 13.4%. But then when you look to your left, you'll note that 5.6% of US adults identify as part of the LGBTQ group. Why that's important is because as of 2020, we had the highest rate of persons who identify as LGBT in Generation Z, meaning persons born after 1997 are more likely to be a part of this LGBT group. And that's important because when we consider persons who identify in this manner, we have to also remember that between the millennials and Gen Z, who make up the greater part of this population at this point, think about who is providing care to those individuals born after 1981. Who are the caretakers, and how are the caretakers relating to those folks, particularly if they're baby boomers or traditionalists? How are they interacting? And are these persons who identify as LGBTQ, are they interfacing and seeking care from people who may not necessarily know about them or know about that culture? One thing that we have to consider as we, not necessarily debate, but as we move into cultural competency, are the factors that shape health outcomes. So when you look at our social determinants of health, you'll notice that contrary to popular belief, socioeconomic factors shape health outcomes. So 40% of where it is that you live, work, play, your zip code determines your health outcomes. So while health behavior is still high at 30%, it's very important for us to keep in mind that socioeconomic factors play a great role in the health outcomes of all humans. And if we liken our health disparity to those who are socially disadvantaged, then you see the correlation with persons who are living off of less income, socially disadvantaged or underrepresented, and how access to care, access to quality care, and their physical environment will also contribute to those health disparities. So if you are in fact a culturally competent provider or moving towards cultural proficiency, how do you work with your patients and incorporate the social determinants of health as you minister to them and provide them care? When we look at the health disparities in Appalachia, you'll note that the cancer mortality rate there is 10% higher than the national average. In addition, the cancer mortality rates for what is considered as the region's distressed counties is 20% higher than the region's non-distressed counties. And then when we look at our diseases of despair, and those diseases of despair relate to overdose, suicide, and liver disease, that mortality is 36% higher than the rate for non-Appalachian United States. And we're looking at that critical age group between 25 and 54, where in Appalachia, the diseases of despair are 43% higher. So when you flip back to the social determinants of health, and you think about the socioeconomic status of the individuals who are in Appalachia, often a rural place that has less access to care, these are the outcomes. These of despair are higher, the cancer rates are higher, the chronic disease rates are higher, and it can be directly correlated with physical environments and the socioeconomic status of those individuals. Now, when we look at disparities by race, you'll note that these disparities exist because African Americans typically represent about 13% of the United States. And for you to only represent 13% of the United States and make up these numbers in terms of chronic disease, 61% for high blood pressure, 23% for diabetes, and 7% for stroke, that is considerably high. Because again, the population is only 13%. So we shouldn't have that much overrepresentation of African Americans in these chronic diseases because they make up so little of the United States by way of percentage. When we look at the Latinx health disparities, we note that their leading causes of death as of last year were COVID-19, heart disease, and cancer. But with respect to COVID-19, we know that as a result of persons who have succumbed to it, they usually had a number of other health conditions, underlying conditions related to diabetes, asthma, respiratory conditions that made it a lot more likely for them to succumb to COVID-19. We also know that the common conditions among that particular group happen to be around obesity and hypertension as well. And when we look at Native Americans, particularly in Alaska Natives, have a number of challenges as it relates to mental health issues. 37% are depressed clinically. 64% have liver cancer issues. Others are 9 times more likely to have TB, I was going to say instead of tuberculosis, TB. 40% are more likely to have heart disease. And again, these numbers are astronomical because Native Americans make up a very small portion of the United States. And when we go back to our LGBT populations that I discussed a little earlier, as millennials and Gen Z folks age, we know that the youth who are lesbian, gay, or bisexual have suicidal challenges. They're 5 times more likely to attempt suicide, whereas adult LGBT populations have higher rates of substance use disorder, including both alcohol and tobacco. And LGBT elders, so that very small population, may experience a lot more social isolation and are twice as likely to live alone. So when you look at these disparities and you look at them, particularly as they relate to race and ethnicity, why do you think that these disparities are exacerbated so much by race, ethnicity, as well as urban versus rural populations? What do you think is going on? Why we see these disparities exacerbated amongst these folks? And you can unmute or write in the chat or type in the chat. Is it a provider challenge? Is it a people challenge, or is it a person challenge? Do you think that there is anything that we can do as providers and health educators to mitigate these disparities? Or is this just a structural issue that we cannot accomplish anything at this point? Susan, thank you.
Yeah, no, I would say much of it is like historical structures of racism that have divided the cultures and prohibited them from the resources and access to both economic prosperity as well as health prosperity.
Thank you, Susan. So we know we have structural challenges. We know that a lot of these challenges arise as a result of racism. I see Sabrina's hand up. Sabrina?
I look at it a lot of, including like generational trauma, right? Like, so historical racism, generational trauma, like that, these factors are really difficult to overcome because they've been so ingrained for so long. I do hope, of course, and like I'm always positive that like we can make change, but like, you know, if you look at the groups that were mentioned, you know, like it's been historic for a very long time, right? And I think there's the external plus the internal, so it's complex for
it's definitely a complex systemic issue. But as providers, thank you, Sabrina, you want to remain hopeful, right? You want to recognize how these adverse childhood experiences, this historical trauma, plays into why certain groups may be more hypertensive than others, or plays into why Native Americans, having been relegated to reservations, don't trust any part of the government, right? They don't want to interact with the government. So how do we reach folks? Is it best to implement our programmatic work on a one-on-one basis? So I work with you, you work with me, or do we spend time trying to dismantle an oppressive system? Is it worth it? You know, it goes back to like that return on investment.
Yeah, that's a great question, especially from a health provider perspective. Where do you spend your time? And I think, you know, a lot of these challenges are really having to be addressed by policies, investments in certain communities over other communities. To really address, you know, poverty and housing and access to care. And at the provider level, people say, how do you do that? Yeah. You don't, I don't think. Exactly. I think you have to get outside support.
Thank you. Thank you for your response, Susan. I think that's one of the things, and I hear this from doctors all the time. They're just like, give me a break. I have 15 minutes with a patient. There's no way that I can address all of these challenges. But while you can't address the challenges, you should still know what's going on in the world and ask questions relevant to your patient demographic. So you're not walking around in a fog. Like, there are things going on that you know nothing about because you don't have the lived experience of the people you serve, but you should still be knowledgeable and empathetic to the degree that you can still do your job, keep your patient healthy and or safe to the extent that you can, and work with others who may be in positions of power to address the various systemic and policy issues that continue to promote residential segregation and having particular races and ethnicities live in clusters that have been redlined historically. Ngozi, I see your hand up.
Yes, I was, I'm thinking about the educational component as far as dismantling, leftovers of racism, you call it, because I was startled, and I don't know the statistic, but a very large number of people that were coming out of medical school in this study just believed that Blacks tolerated pain better. And so that means we're less likely to get prescribed. And if you spend your life in pain, of course you're gonna have worse health outcomes. And that is something that, you know, you don't have to be the governor or the president or a whole lawmaker to seek to dismantle that understanding that has somehow, you know, stuck in the medical community.
Exactly. Thank you. Thank you for your comment. Sabrina, did you still have your hand up, or you had it up from last time?
I did. I am someone with like lived experience who kind of evolved and now is in, you know, in the helping field, is like I say. And the one thing that I really like triggered me was the lack of insight, the lack of transparency, and the lack of cooperation, right? And like, all that takes is a conversation. All it takes is sometimes providers being like, I'm not sure that, like just owning that they just don't know. And then somehow it did create a bond for me and those providers, to be honest with you, because like, there's a bunch of stuff I don't know. And this is like a quote unquote professional, right? Because there is that positionality there. And so like just being open and transparent and like human on a human level, and know that it's like a cooperative process and not a hierarchical process, really helps that person, regardless of what group they're in, if that makes sense.
No, absolutely makes sense. I mean, just the idea of somebody in charge not knowing and admitting to not knowing is like, I don't want to say it's a breath of fresh air, but it's okay. You are not this omnipotent, all-knowing God of gods. You are human. And I think that's what's often lost in translation. These are human beings that went to school, that learned about a particular subject, right? Whether you're a social worker, physician, et cetera. That's how that happened. It doesn't mean that these individuals know everything. And for a doctor to admit that, like, I'm going to do the research and get back to you, it's pretty humbling, and it should make a patient feel like, I can trust this person, because this person is actually admitting to the fact that they don't know something and will get back to me. So I do think that that's a wonderful way to foster trust, by admitting what you don't know. And Jason, I'm looking at your comment. It's definitely worth it to seek positive change. Any changes we make today can affect not just us, but the persons that are coming behind us. And yes, especially with respect to medical school and persons who are graduating, if you are graduating this year and you really think that Black people don't feel pain the same way, that's problematic. Like, that's not what should be happening in 2023. But I know the publication that you're talking about. And I want to say that was published at least one of the last data that I read was in 2021. So there still are a vast proportion of medical students who are leaving school with that idea of who takes pain better, which is problematic. And yes, the number is very high, but we also have to keep in mind, while these individuals may be Gen Z folks, that they're being taught by those traditionalists and baby boomers. And until the traditionalists and baby boomers retire or take a really, really long break, we're going to continue to have some of these things come up, which is problematic. So just to wrap up, we just have a couple more slides. So think about this process as a lifelong journey, right? And when you're speaking with those that you work with or your colleagues, think about this wheel in terms of how we look at our attitude, skills, and knowledge as it relates to cultural competence. Think about it, as they say, as a marathon and not a sprint, or a journey and not an endpoint. And then, you know, similar to our stages of change, where are you along the continuum? Are you open to ongoing reflection and environmental feedback? Are you willing and able, or are you unwilling and able? Because again, throughout the life course, you'll find yourself along different parts of this journey, and the people that you work with may be along different parts of this journey as well. And our job is just to educate, because, you know, at the end of the day, people are going to do what they want to do. But if you want to serve people in healthcare, we really need to make a concerted effort to be among the willing and able. One way to do so is by incorporating person-first language. So if you are an individual who doesn't have the same lived experience as your population, one of the things that you can do to get a little closer to working with our population is not using deficit-based language like addict, frequent flyer, describing folks as hostile and aggressive or mentally ill or lazy, but instead, if you're working with populations who have substance use disorder, it's a person with a substance use disorder. It's actually a whole human being with a mental illness. They're not mentally ill. For individuals who, and you may have heard this depending on where you live, certain groups of people abuse the system. Instead, we can reimagine this or reframe this and call this individual a good self-advocate. So really consider how we identify people and move towards language that we incorporate strengths-based positions to really have folks feeling like full and whole human beings. So if we're looking for equity in healthcare, or we're seeking equity in healthcare, we should have equal access for people in equal need, equal treatment for people in equal need, and equal treatment outcomes for people in equal need. So remember, one of the differences between equity and equality is this idea of giving people what they need, not equal portions of something, but recognizing that everybody has a different starting point and ensuring that we give everybody what they need so they're on the same level, that they're starting from the same place. Other ways, yes, you can absolutely email me if you have any questions. Other ways to incorporate cultural competency is via inclusion. So I mentioned the LGBTQ population. is going through a number of changes and iterations as it relates to the fluidity of sexuality, as well as persons who are non-binary and or asexual. What does that mean? If you are a provider and you are in urban America or rural America, it would be helpful for you to know about this particular group of people because their needs are a little different from mainstream individuals or persons that you see on a regular basis. In addition, the LGBTQ population has a really hard time seeking medical care because a lot of the people that they go to are not culturally competent, let alone culturally proficient in this subject matter. In addition, accessibility. We know that the medical model of disability is what we have used for a very long time. Instead, we should be moving towards the social model of disability, where we recognize how the world has placed a number of barriers on persons who may be neurodivergent in their ability, or eyeballing people and saying, oh, you don't look like you need an accommodation, but that individual does. And our job is to reduce the barriers so that individuals can get what it is they need. And I mentioned that cultural competency is in fact a journey. It is not cross-sectional. It is not just a professional development exercise and then walking away, but instead it is a lifelong learning process where you go through various iterations until you are culturally proficient. So in summary, to put cultural competence into action, healthcare organizations should create an institutional framework that demonstrates culturally competent practices, that cultivates this cross-cultural awareness and communication, and also maintains a diverse workforce. Cultural competence demands ongoing commitment and a multi-pronged approach. This is not a one-size-fits-all approach ever. And healthcare organizations must build this infrastructure that supports activities and protocols to ensure culturally competent practices. And with that said, I'm going to stop the share and ask you all if you have any questions or is there anything that you wish to discuss in our remaining 4 or 5 minutes. Anyone? Comments, questions, concerns? I'd be happy to answer anything that you have.
I would be curious to hear your insight as to what you think the next 20 years of healthcare looks like, as far as where is the field going, the medical field going in terms of cultural competency and its application in medical care and treatment.
Sure. Thank you. So I work with medical students. I like to believe that I'm very hopeful about how they think and how they see individuals. The challenge, I think, with respect to physicians or providers who are physicians, is that the medical school model is still a very elitist bubble that we know 75% of persons enrolled in medical school have parents who are physicians, which means that we're able to diversify that group, we're going to continue to have the same challenges around pain management for people of color, et cetera. But I'd like to believe that as our Gen Zers become more educated, that they'll be pushing the diversity angle. I don't think we're going to see much of a change until we have a concerted effort to dismantle those systems of oppression. Because of the way healthcare is set up, it's a capitalistic structure and it's very profit-based and profit-driven, it's going to be very, very difficult to change health outcomes if we are unable to change the systems that exist. One way I think of doing that is really mobilizing people. I think that a lot of our underrepresented or underserved populations don't fully realize the position they have, the position of power that they have. When you are limited from a socioeconomic standpoint, you know, you're short-sighted because you're just thinking about how to get to the next day, versus if you really have the time or have the leadership that can promote what optimal and fair and just care looks like, it's worth fighting for. And I think that's the narrative that we need to push. The government is not going to listen to us any other way. We have to be able to really mobilize communities, for communities to understand that they have a right to excellent healthcare. And right now, I think that it's so run and based on capitalism that it's going to be very, very difficult for anything to change in the next 30 years. I think it's going to be still the haves and the have-nots unless we change our medical model, unless medical school model, and we change the systems that have been in place for our community. So, you know, as an educator, I try to remain hopeful and I teach as many students as I can. And I pray that they go out and advocate for persons who are in need, but also bring those persons to the table so that they can get the things that they want. Sabrina.
I heard as I was, you know, getting my assistance, meeting people where they're at is like just a wonderful term, and it should be taken in every profession, right? Like, yeah. Especially in healthcare, dealing with addictions, things of that sort. That's the first step, is just understanding where someone is in their life at that moment and kind of working with what you have and what each other can give, right? And that's like the first step. So like, that's what I thought about when you were just speaking. It's just meeting people where they're at is so powerful.
Thank you, Sabrina. And on that note, we will close. Thank you all for your participation today. I'm so pleased with the number of people we have and the questions that I got. This was fantastic. I hope that you have a wonderful remainder of your week, and I will see you next time. Take care. Bye.